In the waters of the baptism, Leonard Wieckowski died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory. Amen. On the day of the baptism, Leonard Wieckowski was clothed with Christ. May God welcome him in the fullness of his love and lead him to eternal life. Amen. Let us pray. O God, Almighty Father, our faith professes that your Son died and rose again. Merciful grant that through this mystery, your servant Leonard Wieckowski, who has fallen asleep in Christ, may rejoice to rise again through him, who live and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. Wieckowski, the great prince, guardian of your people. It shall be a time unsurpassed in distress since nations began until that time. At that time, your people shall escape, everyone who is found written in the book. Many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake. Some shall live forever, others shall be in everlasting horror and disgrace. But the wise shall shine brightly, like the splendor of the firmament, and those who leave the many to justice shall be like the stars forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. None of us lives for oneself, and no one dies for oneself. For if we live, we live for the Lord, and if we die, we die for the Lord. So then whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For this is why Christ died and came to life, that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. For we shall stand before the judgment seat of God, for it is written, As I live, say the Lord, every knee shall bend before me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each of us shall give an account of himself to God. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus told his disciples, The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Amen, amen, I say to you, Unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains just a grain of wheat. But if it dies, it produces much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it. And whoever hates his life in this world will preserve it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there also will my servant be. The Father will honor whoever serves me. I am troubled now, yet what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? But it was for this purpose that I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it and will glorify it again. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Judy, Leanne, Christopher, Keith, Mark, Paul, all the gathered family, friends, St. Isaac's, on behalf of our pastor, Father Jose, Father Enrique, and everyone here, we offer our sincere condolences on the passing of Len. Some years ago, my wife and I went on a trip to Europe, and we went to Versailles. That's that great big palace that's right outside of Paris. We had a tour of one of the buildings, and someone on the tour group asked, how many seats are there in this theater room we were in? I don't think the guide knew the answer. I don't think she was even expecting that kind of question. She was more interested in the size and scale and decoration. What's the overall impression you get from this theater room? I never did hear an answer to that question. And at the time, it seemed rather unimportant to me. But many years ago, that answer mattered to somebody, and that somebody has probably been lost to history. After all, somebody had to order the seats and had to get them made and arranged just so within the theater. Otherwise, nobody would have enjoyed it. And so it was with Len. He was intimately involved in the construction of this building we are sitting in today. And on any given day during the construction process, Len could have told you how many bricks had been stacked, how many tiles had been put down on the floor. And without that anonymous labor on the part of Len, caring about the little details, we would not be sitting in this building today. Paul teaches us in our second reading that we don't live for ourselves, and we don't die for ourselves either. When he was baptized, Len, like each of us, becomes the Lord's special possession. And he asks us to order our lives around the service of the Lord. So all that paying attention to the details of construction, important and necessary, but Len didn't do them for the glory of Len. No, he did them for the glory of God. And if we're ordering our lives around the Lord, all this paying attention to the details, it's going to happen, and probably nobody will notice. I did not pay strict attention during construction of this building, although I was here at the time. But the Lord does notice, and he will notice, and the Lord is going to remember, and he's going to call us to that place he's prepared for us since the beginning of time. In our gospel, Jesus asks us to die to ourselves and to serve him. And if we don't do that, we're not going to bear fruit. As Jesus is saying this, he knows his passion, his death. It's right around the corner. And Jesus knew what was coming. And if he did not die to himself, die on the cross, our faith wouldn't matter. Yes, the road of discipleship, it's not easy. And the rewards that truly matter don't come in this life. Bearing fruit, that's the mission of us. Being faithful to the place where we are planted. And whatever effort Len put into this building, and it's a lot, it doesn't seem like much when we look at the effort he put into his relationship with God, with his wife of 62 years, Judy, and his children and his grandchildren. You know, it's never, never easy to say goodbye, especially if we think in human terms, death seems so final. But if we die to ourselves, order our lives around the faithful service of God, death is just the beginning of an eternal life, united with the saints and the angels in heaven. That is the hope that springs from the waters of baptism. As Jesus assures us, where I am, there also will my servant be. Where Jesus is now, there also Len will be. That is the hope of the Christian. That is God's plan for each and every one of us. Unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains just that, a grain of wheat. But if it dies, it produces much fruit. You need only look around to see the fruit that results from Len dying to himself. This building, it's a small part of the fruit that he bore. More importantly, is the family he helped form. Len may no longer be with us in this life, but his fruit lives on. I can imagine now that Len is probably starting to tap on his watch, letting me know it's time to stop. And so it is. Saints of God, come to Len's aid. Hasten to meet him, angels of the Lord. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High.
God the Almighty Father raised Christ, his Son, from the dead. With confidence, we ask him to save all his people, living and dead.
And please respond, Lord, hear our prayer to the petitions. For Leonard Wieckowski, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be admitted to the company of saints, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For our brother Leonard, who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, that he may be raised up on the last day, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For our deceased relatives and friends, and for all who have preceded them in death, that they may have the reward of their goodness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all those who have fallen asleep with the hope of rising again, that they may see God face to face, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For the family and friends of our brother Leonard, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may know how to console each other with words of faith and hope until we may be gathered again in God's kingdom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
God, our shelter, in our strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for our departed brother, Leonard Wieckowski. Cleanse him of their sin and grant him the fullness of redemption, as we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I have called you
faith, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
As we humbly present to you the sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant, Leonard Wieckowski, we beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt your son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
In giving thanks to our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the centrally of thine might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the host and power of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as we down and we acclaim. Holy, O Lord, the Font of all holiness. May holy, therefore, this gift we pray, by sending down your Spirit to open them, let you do for, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed, and entering willingly into his passion, he took bread and giving thanks, brought it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, he gave it to the disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which we will pour out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life in the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the full needs of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, and John Nuna, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant, Leonard Wieckowski, whom you have called today from his word to yourself. Grant that he, who was united with your son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints, so please you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor your forever and ever. At the Savior command, and for my divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and a unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
You take away the sins of
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who take away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you shall enter under my roof. A holy Savior, worthy of my church, shall be here. Christ. Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body, food for the journey, merciful grant that, strengthened by the eat, our brothers Leonard Wieckowski may come to the eternal table of Christ, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated. I'd like to ask Keith if you want to come up and share some with us.
So my parents were married in February 1961. Their wedding happened in Philadelphia in the middle of winter, so not surprising there was a blizzard on their wedding day. My grandmother shoveled out a spot in front of her house for the newlyweds to park after their service. My wife's from Boston, and they call this Southie rules. You clear out a spot, it's yours. Well, I guess they didn't get the memo in Fishtown because somebody did the unthinkable and parked in that freshly cleared spot. So all 5'1" of my grandma took all that snow, buried the perp back in there, and rightly so. Now let's fast forward in time to when Mark, Paul, and I were around ages 5 to 8. Dad was on a short business trip, and Mom went with him. So rather than leaving us kids to fend for ourselves, my dad's parents stayed over and took care of us. We were eating dinner, and anything that we kids didn't eat, my grandmother made my grandfather eat. Now, I don't recall that I ever heard my grandfather talk, you know, make more than 2 sentences in a row at any time, but he shot her a look and said, "Thank you for making me fat." 50 years later, this is still the funniest thing I've ever heard. So I bring these stories up because it's the stories that keep our loved ones alive in our hearts. When my daughter was young, she used to ask me to tell her family stories. She said, "I find them fascinating." And I just found telling the stories really brought me closer to the people that were not around. My dad was the subject of many of these stories, and I'm gonna share a few of them with you over the next 3 hours. Just kidding, just kidding. So, Dad grew up in a rather poor section of Philadelphia. His parents were both factory workers, and their home was actually close to several factories. These were the days before the EPA, and God only knows what was being dumped into the soil and, you know, made its way wherever. My dad's house actually had a dirt floor. And so he and my Uncle Bob used to dig foxholes and play war. They would throw lit firecrackers at each other, and, you know. So it's not really a coincidence that in the end they both suffered from the same disease. After high school, my mom and dad actually went to work for the same bank. My mom used to talk about seeing this good-looking guy on the bus with his nose buried in a paper, and they actually never met. As fate would have it, they both were invited to a mutual friend's wedding. That's when they met, and they knew they found their person. I didn't actually know this till yesterday, but I guess it was like their second date, and they decided that's when they were gonna get married. Brothers were saying, you know, they were 19 at the time, so they kinda had to tell, you know, kinda hold off on telling that. But my mom used to talk about how Dad would be waiting for her outside the bank with his straw hat and his seersucker suit. And maybe this is the reason why seersucker has always been my go-to fabric. They were married 62 years, and they had 6 kids and 9 grandkids. Sadly, the oldest child, my dad's namesake, passed as a baby. During their many years together, my dad would do some big romantic gestures for my mom now and again. I think he learned that from his father. My grandfather had a tradition of sending my grandmother flowers on their anniversary. Well, one year he was away in Europe working for World War II, and it was on their anniversary, but he still found a way to get them flowers. Now remember, this was 1940-something, and 1-800-Flowers was not an option. So when Mom turned 60, Dad arranged a surprise celebration for her, with a couple of us flying in from out of state. About 10 years later, on their 50th wedding anniversary, he had a surprise weekend stay at Universal. Now, in both cases, everybody was in on it except Mom. Now, just for symmetry, when they celebrated their 60th anniversary, we did another Universal trip, but Mom was in on that one. Okay. Despite working full-time and going to school, My dad always found time for us kids. My favorite memory was a game we used to call hide and seek in the dark. The game was exactly that. We'd turn off all the lights in the house, he'd hide, we'd seek. And it was amazing the nooks and crannies that man could wedge his way into. He served as a scoutmaster for many years and actually founded Troop 91 in Hamilton Square. I checked online and the troop is still active today. What started with three young men in 1975 has grown to about 65 members. I remember we'd go on many camping trips and Dad would never be without his handy camp manual. It was a book called Roughing It Easy. And I mean, just because you were in the wilds of New Jersey did not mean you should be without your hot comb. For those of you wondering, a hot comb is essentially an ancestor of a blow dryer. He taught all us kids how to drive. He tried teaching mom to drive, but I think they decided that staying married was more important. So she ended up taking driving lessons from the high school driver's ed instructor who happened to be a neighbor. Mom failed a road test a few times, primarily because of parallel parking. Now, this isn't part of the Florida road test, but it's actually heavily weighted in New Jersey. So when we began driver's ed, my dad put a heavy emphasis on parallel parking. Now, I can't speak for the other kids, but for years, I could not just pull up to a curve and park. I actually had to go through the motions of parallel parking, whether there were cars there or not. He encouraged us to make our own decisions, but Dad wasn't shy to give advice. He had very strong opinions, particularly when it came to which political party to vote for, itemizing the deductions on your tax return, how much umbrella insurance to carry, and the importance of having a colonoscopy after the age of 40. I direct the latter one to my brother, Chris. However, the best advice he gave me was in the spring of 2000. I was home on a visit, I was telling Dad about a gal I started dating, and when I mentioned that the lady had a heart of gold like my mom, he said, you should marry her, and so I did. Understatement of the year coming up. My dad was a very competitive person. At least he came by it honestly. My mom used to talk about going to visit my grandparents when they were dating, and a bunch of my grandfather's siblings would be over and they'd be playing cards. Suffice to say, by the end of the night, things escalated. With Dad, his competitive streak would show up often, but especially in sports. He once broke his foot in a pickup basketball game and continued to play till the end of the game. During friendly touch football games, he was known to throw clothesline tackles that NFL great Jack Tatum would be proud of. But if you really wanted to see Dad at his competitive best, you had to witness a family volleyball game. Let's just say, if you were opposite him in front of the net, you were there at your own risk. I don't know how many of you recall the 1972 Olympics, and more specifically, the controversial men's basketball final. U.S. had seemed to win the game. Dad was whooping it up. Woo-hoo! And after a couple minutes and a couple of restarts, Russia was awarded the gold. As for Dad's reaction, let's just say Dad weaved a stream of obscenities that, as far as we know, today is still today floating over the Delaware Valley. My youngest brother played youth soccer for many years, and while Dad didn't coach, he was in the stands, well, being Dad. To this day, I think he's the only spectator in Hamilton U-12 soccer to receive a red card. After that, I believe the league and my mom thought it best he serve a 5-game suspension. But over time, Dad mellowed. He over the last few years, he really enjoyed watching my nephew's baseball games and my niece's synchronized swim meets with little risk of being ejected. Even when he couldn't attend in person, he would follow their activities online, and he got a great deal of joy watching their athletic achievements. I think you'd be hard-pressed to find a bigger Philadelphia sports fan than my dad. I can remember back in the early 1970s, I don't think the Sixers, Phillies, and Eagles could boast 20 wins between them. I'd like to say Dad took these losses in stride, but I'm in church and I really shouldn't lie. My sister talked about learning some rather colorful phrases from watching my dad watch Philly sports. One incident, and I apologize for whoever was at the wake, but it's a repeat, sticks out with me. The Eagles missed a chip shot field goal to lose a game to the Washington Redskins. Without going into detail, my dad killed our rocking chair that day. But all those years of losing finally changed with the Flyers. Our beloved Broad Street Bullies won back-to-back Stanley Cups in 1974 and 75. This led the way to future successes. Eventually, the Sixers and Phillies both won championships, but the Eagles still kept getting denied. They experienced a lot of success over the years, but just could not win the Super Bowl. But finally, in 2018, we did it. If nothing else, he lived to see that. And, you know, I just say, fly, Eagles, fly. My dad didn't like to talk about how generous he was, because he was humble. The book of Matthew talks about giving of your time, talent, and treasure. Dad gave all three frequently and generously. He and Mom created several college scholarships and assigned it to specific types of individuals. For example, they endowed scholarships specifically targeted towards single parents. Mom mentioned that over the years, they've received over 100 thank you letters from individuals they've helped. Talk about making an impact. He and Mom established a charitable trust. Now, rather than taking the credit for the donations and stuff, each of our kids would every year get a certain amount of money that we could donate to our own charities of choice. Now, lest you think his help was limited to just writing checks, I'm going to set the record straight. Before they moved to Florida, my dad was a regular server at various local food soup kitchens. He was actually awarded a Volunteer of the Year one year for his efforts. But I think the best example of Dad giving of his time and talent is the church where we're assembled. I won't go into a lot of it here because it's already been covered, but you know, he spent countless hours and making this happen, in for a penny, in for a pound. That was my dad. Dad held many titles over the years: senior vice president, scoutmaster, driving instructor, and once the grandkids came along, he got his last and probably favorite title, Grumps. Apparently, while my brother Paul and wife were expecting the first grandchild, Dad was trying to figure out, well, what handle should he go by? His assistant at McGraw-Hill said that instead of Gramps with an A, maybe Grumps with a U would be a better choice. That's the name he's gone by proudly for over 25 years. Every day, he and my mom would have anywhere from 2 to 9 grandkids running about their house. It could be chaotic, but they loved it. Trips to the Orlando Science Center, Orlando area theme parks, the baseball field became their new norm. My parents were the hardest working retirees that I know. One story that particularly sticks out in my mind: Dad used to drive carpool for my sister Leanne's girls. The carpool kids loved him, called him Grumps as well. It was probably a 25-minute commute from their house to the school. And kids being kids, sometimes things would go south. So one time, a kid who was no relation pulled the hair of another kid in the car. Well, without missing a beat, Dad being Dad, pulled that kid's hair and said, "Hurts, doesn't it?" Needless to say, there were no more hair pulling on his watch. Like most family, we went on vacation together. However, my parents felt that just because their kids were grown with kids, there was no reason to end this tradition. I don't recall exactly how it all started, but I believe my dad and several siblings got their scuba certifications, so we ended up going wherever there was water. My dad lived for planning these vacations. Before the current vacation was done, he would actually be scouting out the next location. One of the running jokes before he retired was he would oftentimes be found on the phone with work, you know, planning out this detail or that. I remember the first day on one of the vacations, Dad was off arranging the dives and such. A couple of us actually did the unthinkable. We went grocery shopping. So after Dad got finished with the dive shop, he called and said, "Okay, I got the diving sorted. I'm going to head to the grocery store now." He was tongue-tied when I told him, "Oh, it's already been covered." We eventually settled on Siesta Key as the site of our vacations. Past 11 or 12 years, we would head there for the July 4th week. A few weeks out, Dad would get real excited as the time drew closer, and he was in charge of logistics. We would know who was cooking what on what night. We would have grocery lists. We would have a full itinerary, which included pontoon boats, paddle boards, fishing, and beach time. Suffice to say, the Normandy invasion wasn't as well planned as a Wieckowski family vacation. Even when his health started going downhill, he still loved those trips and spending time with us. We'd wheel him down onto the beach with what could be best described as a mix between a wheelchair and a dune buggy. Living out of state for many of these years, these vacations were particularly special to me, Sue, and Grace. It was a chance for Grace to hang with her cousins in a safe environment, and I hope we continue what they started. Unfortunately, this year, we had to cancel the trip because Dad's health wouldn't allow it. However, I think this year, Dad went to Siesta Key on his own terms. As I mentioned, my dad's health started going downhill the last few years, probably the last 7 or 8 years. He experienced more than most people would experience in 3 lifetimes. Despite being robbed of the ability to speak, and in the end walk by Parkinson's, undergoing chemo, suffering from mutant kidney stones the size of a quarter, Dad never complained. He never gave up. I think it was his faith and love of family that kept him going. He always felt there was more to teach us. Don't worry, Dad, we're good. You did good. I would be remiss if I didn't take a minute to point out just how much my mother supported him in this fight. Takes in sickness and in health to the next level. She was his voice, his advocate, spent countless hours chauffeuring him to his appointments and just hanging with him in the hospital. There were times we'd be over the folks' house and Mom would literally fall asleep mid-conversation because she was so exhausted. In the end, broken knee and all, there was no hope. She was just in the hospital holding his hand. I and my brothers can recall, you know, we'd be driving Dad sometimes, and he would point the directions where he would want to go. He was not going to let a little thing like Parkinson's prevent him from backseat driving. But honestly, I don't think any of us minded, because that simple act let us know he was still there. I take a lot of comfort in knowing he's now in a place where he's able to talk people's ears off, and for all we know, he's out walking his beloved dogs, Trink and Ariel, or maybe he and my late brother are playing in a 2-on-2 basketball tournament against Jesus and his dad. I know there's a lot of other stories I could share, but you know, we'll save that for another time. Our hearts are broken right now, but as time goes on, we will heal. But there'll always be a small piece missing until we see him again. And yes, we will see him again. I'd like to wrap with a quote from the movie Big Fish. If you tell a man's stories enough, he eventually becomes part of them. They live on after him, and in that way, he becomes immortal. I always thought my dad would live forever, and as long as we continue to tell his stories, he'll live on forever in all of us. Thank you.
Judy.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Leonard in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you have bestowed upon Leonard in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.